Hi, how's everybody doing? Thank you for being here. My name is Kassondra Watson, and I'm glad to be here too. I'm pretty excited to have this opportunity to present about what I've been working on for the past 8 months, discovering the relationship between plankton community composition and global climate functions in real time with NASA's future plankton aerosols, clouds, and ecosystems mission, which is also known as PACE. I am a student researcher with Ann Thompson's lab, the Microbial Oceanography Lab, and I've been doing that for about a year. I'm also a biology student at PSU. So here's a brief overview of my topics today. So first I'll give you, I'll explain what my fellowship award was and what I propose to do for it. And then I'll get to give you some background information about phytoplankton, remote sensing, and ocean color. And that'll lead me into a major problem that a lot of oceanographers are facing right now. And then I can talk about PACE some more, and I can tell you about how I think it will help solve some of those problems, and then go into some applications of PACE. Excuse me. So the Student Academic Research Review Fellowship Award was granted to me from the Oregon's NASA Space Grant Consortium in September. And so my proposed topic for a 10-page research review is, what will the NASA's PACE mission reveal about the relationship between phytoplankton community composition, carbon cycling, and climate change? And so this has actually been a lot of work and I've gained a lot of new skills. So what are phytoplankton anyway? So phytoplankton, phyto means plant-like because they're photosynthetic, and plankton means drifter because they're subject to the movement of the water in which they live. They're usually microscopic, single-celled organisms. I have a couple examples on this slide here. So if you've ever heard of diatomaceous earth, that's going to be the silica cell walls of this diatom, which is a type of algae. It's actually a rather large-sized phytoplankton, one of the largest, it is the largest group. And then on the total counterpart of that, one of the smallest phytoplankton is known as Prochlorococcus. My advisor, Ann Thompson, focuses on a lot of her research on Prochlorococcus, and this image was taken by her, and mad props for being able to get a photo of cell division right there. Great. So the thing that unites all phytoplankton is that they're photosynthetic, right? So they all have the ability to take the sunlight's energy and use it to break the bond between carbon and oxygen from carbon dioxide in the air. And so they use that carbon and they assimilate it into their own bodies and use it for their own cellular processes. And so they really are the ones fixing carbon from the atmosphere and putting it into the food chain. So they're really the foundation of the food web in marine ecosystems. This image here, I don't really think it's important for you to know all the acronyms and numbers. I just think it is very helpful explaining a really important process called the biological carbon pump. So I really just want you to look at, so this is the surface ocean where the phytoplankton are. They get eaten by zooplankton that are a little deeper, and then eventually these things will either aggregate together and sink, or larger and larger and larger organisms will eat them and accumulate that carbon. And as they accumulate it up the food chain, they're going to be going down in depths. And so the most efficient way really to get the greenhouse gas carbon dioxide out of our atmosphere is with the biological carbon pump here. There's also a microbial carbon pump or microbial loop, but I don't have time to talk about it, unfortunately. So some things I'm really interested in is how plankton communities change over time and space. So seasonally, there's always going to be changes. If it's warmer, there's more sunlight. It also brings in new nutrients with seasonal shifts. So that plays a large role. Ecological, classic, and ecological interactions like competition, predator prey, but particularly mutual symbiosis and even more so endosymbiosis. It's actually very, very, very prevalent among phytoplankton and microbes in general. Some potentially human-caused or human factors that could influence plankton communities are ocean temperatures and ocean acidity. Ocean acidity could potentially eliminate some types of phytoplankton that are really important. Pollution puts in tons and tons of nutrients, so that can lead to huge blooms. That sounds really great. Lots of carbon, right? No, actually kills everything else that's in there. So, and that creates harmful algal blooms often. And that'll often lead to waters that don't have any oxygen in them. So it's really important that there is dissolved oxygen in waters for the communities. So this animation, I think, is a really beautiful representation of the flow and the changes in plankton community compositions throughout space and time. So up here is a Venn diagram. So if you have this light blue, you have one main type of plankton. You have this darker blue, it's another coccolithophores. Yellow is going to be diatoms, and red is going to be dinoflagellates. This light blue is picoplankton, which includes the prochlorococcus. So if you see these overlay colors, that means there's more than one of these types of plankton in the same place at the same time. This whitish peach color here, that means that all four types of phytoplankton are in the same spot. So we're starting in 1997 in January. So you can really see this yellow changing as we move into the summer. And then when we get into winter, it gets really yellow in the south. So that's moving like some of those factors that I just discussed. So that's going to be your seasonal changes, the amount of light and temperatures, and the rivers that flow into here. So oftentimes in springs or right when it's starting to get warm, you get a lot more river flow into the oceans, which brings tons of nutrients as well. And so what my main focus here is that global changes can impact community composition, and plankton community shifts can influence global conditions as well. And then those two things are also going to change how efficient the biological carbon pump is. So now I get to talk about ocean color. I actually have some fun things to do right now. So I want you to think of how now. So this is blue. This isn't extremely accurate, but imagine that we're just seeing one band of color. And so this is what you could see if you could only see blue. If you had a lot of phytoplankton pigments, like you see in this region of this figure, it might look something like. So this image really, it goes from kind of a brownish color, and it's much of a gradient, but we're going from sand land terrestrial zones and going into shallow waters where we get some of that bluish green. And then when there's tons of plankton, we see a lot of their pigments in the water. And then when it's just dissolved matter like oxygen and detritus or whatever other dissolved matter, you'll get kind of this lighter shade of blue. And in deep waters, you're gonna get the darkest blues. And so I also set up this graph from Chen Blankenship that was originally just these lines showing chlorophyll A, B, D, and F, and what this is should be absorbance, I believe, on the y-axis here. And so I overlaid this gradient of colors just to give you an idea of where each color sits on the spectrum of light, because it's really the most important part of ocean color. So remote sensing is really just the instrumentation that is on satellites. And so remote sensing used for ocean color in the United States has all been done through NASA. So the first one began in 1978. So if you see here,
these are like the bands that I was just talking about. So in 1978, we could see this color. This color. And so not a lot, you know, when you put it on blender, I have a lot more colors going on over here. Over time, we've kind of accumulated more and more bands and been able to see more and more details. But even still, we really have quite a range that we're not able to see. So the big problem that I see in microbial oceanography is that the global climate is really limited because the current satellite data, it says little about plankton community composition. It reads chlorophyll as one chlorophyll, and it might not even detect some chlorophylls, but it lumps all plankton together. So you know there's plankton there, phytoplankton there, but you don't know who they are, who there are more of or less of, or how things are changing at all. And so that brings me back to the biological carbon pump again. This is a similar figure from the same paper from Zhang et al. And I really just wanted to remind you of how carbon moves from the atmosphere through phytoplankton, through zooplankton, and down the food chain and deeper. And if it reaches the ocean floor, it can stay there for thousands of years. So that leads me to PACE. PACE, Plankton Aerosol Clouds and Ecosystems, is going to be launching in next year, the year after. It's going to have hyperspectral resolution, which is what I'm most excited about. That means that instead of having bands, just seeing the whole range of the color spectrum and actually more than what our eyes can see. So we're going from UV light to near infrared. It's also going to be using LiDAR, which instead of reading the reflections from the sun, which I don't know if anybody's ever had to deal with reflections, but it can be very obstacle. And so using LiDAR, it uses lasers. It can measure the amount of light it sends down and how much light is sent back up and what wavelengths. And it also has two polarimeters, which also increase or also decrease the amount of reflectance and increase the resolution. It also will be orbiting the Earth in 2 days. So things I think are really cool about it beyond the tech stuff is it'll be able to see down to about 1,000 meters in the ocean, which is incredible. Cloud composition, atmosphere composition, the role of it's going to be seeing aerosols, and we'll be able to follow them through the carbon cycle and see how important they are. And then air quality as well. But what I'm most excited about is being able to distinguish with pigments, find different ratios. So each different plankton has different ratios of chlorophylls, and we'll be able to use those unique fingerprint pigments, so to speak, to identify who's there and when and in real time. So it's really quite exciting. And just as a nice reminder, this is the most recent satellite that's been used in ocean color. So you only get four readouts here, eight, because we're looking at two different things, but then what PACE would see is just that whole spectrum. It's really quite amazing. Some applications are that we'll be able to monitor community changes over time. We'll be able to correlate with data collected on the ground or in the water, I should say. And we'll be able to detect harmful algal blooms. We might be able to use this information for rehabilitating dead zones in the ocean and bioremediating to bioengineer. And so there's really just a lot of capabilities, a lot of possibilities in our future with PACE. And with that, I'd just like to say thank you. And any feedback you could give me is more than welcome. I appreciate you watching my presentation, and I hope you learn something and gain an appreciation for phytoplankton. I did want to say that all my visuals came from NASA.gov or my own, or are cited. Thank you, and have a great summer.